I feel that Krishna has set his agents in different places from life before. It looks like that, because some people join Krishna consciousness and intuitively agree with everything and understand everything and love everything and easily represent everything, whereas others, they can't catch it even after hearing it for 10 years. They still go, no, what's that? I don't know. So, in this way, it's really pretty amazing. Krishna consciousness is amazing. I think we have to send a quick message of wake up service through the Brahmachari quarters. Why don't you do that, Radhadasya? Get our Chaitanya here and some others. Shishi Guru Guranga Lada Nandavika Govinda Sundara Kichaya. The unofficial opening, where's the Sharango? So let's have an unofficial little bacha.
Govindam Ati Purusham Shambhu Namah Padam.
But I'm saying this is me in 1984, you know, I was still a member of ISKCON. And you see, ISKCON is one letter here of very many other words. Anyway, I was a member of ISKCON, and after the disappearance of my guru, Srila Prabhupada, 1977, 7 years had passed. 7 years which are difficult to describe, not even so important. Only I can tell you they were quite painful. Living spiritual life in the separation of your guru is not an easy thing. Srila Bhaktivedanta Srila Maharaj said, it is the last and the heaviest instruction our guru gives to us in our life when he withdraws his earthly visible presence. When he disappears from our sight. This is his last lesson. And it is a most difficult one to digest, but generally we have to experience it. As a matter of fact, I already experienced it 3 times by my prominent sannyas and shiksha guru's disappearance, as well as the disappearance of Prabhupada, because guru tattva has an expanding feature. It doesn't necessarily focus only on one person, even though one or the other person may be the most prominent in this connection. As a matter of fact, Srila Prabhupada is the most prominent for me, and I guess for most of you as well. So, 1984 I was here. There was no Vrinda mission. There was only myself and my feeling very upset that I thought that the mission of my spiritual master was not very well represented. Well, I would say in Colombia at that time, because that's where I was living. I can't really speak for all of the world, nor can I care for all of the world. I have to just care for myself, for my preaching, for my life, for my sadhana. It's very nice to be internationally concerned, but first you have to take care of who you are and what you're doing. So in 1984, I came to the conclusion that by the inspiration of Srila Bhakti Rakhak Srila Deva Goswami Maharaj, I had to take responsibility for my preaching on my own shoulders. In other words, I decided that I would start a Vaishnava family, which I did together with Srila Harijan Maharaj, one of my godbrothers, because he was Colombian, and I had previously proposed him to be a spiritual master of Colombia, because before that, other people would initiate in Colombia after Prabhupada's departure, and they didn't show any interest or any time, nothing, in what was going on. That was maybe the prime problem, that you had spiritual masters who had no more connection with reality. No concern, no care, but still some influence through the policy making, which was becoming often detrimental. So that was the history. Here I was. Now I started my own Vaishnava family. This is not so strange. This is almost as natural as a child getting married and starting your own family. So it's not like really a phenomena out of this world. it's something which just has to happen at certain points in life when there's nobody else to take care of. So I started my own family, but that means you, who later came to me as my disciples, were coming from what we call here the general population. You came from here, so you met me. Now, I was thinking, my goodness, how am I going to explain to my disciples of who are we representing? Of course, Guru Parampara, that's a very traditional thing, and every disciple, he represents the Parampara. So this is not so complicated to understand. But we are in a world where we have to represent things in a way people in general can also understand. So when I left ISKCON, I wasn't very highly appreciated for doing so. And I also didn't appreciate very highly the criteria of the ISKCON leaders, otherwise I wouldn't have left. So I was in a kind of a rebellion, by their point of view, spiritual search and reform, by my point of view. So here I'm going to start a family. Then I said, what is before us? I said, well, before us, there's ISKCON, and there's the Gaudiya Math, because ISKCON came from the Gaudiya Math. Also from the Gaudiya Math came the Chaitanya Math and the Gaudiya Mission, that were the main branches, and then many Maths of Srila Prabhupada's disciples. Nowadays, they are known as Gaudiya Maths, but they all started in rebellion with these two institutions, just like our institution started in rebellion with ISKCON and many other organizations come. Rebellion means trying to improve things, not a rebellion for the sake of rebellion or independence. No, rebellion for the sake of purity, clarity, sanity, and transparency. So I said, then, how can I tell my disciples they are part of some genuine family? So then I said, well, let me look at the Gaudiya Math. And I found out that in the Gaudiya Math, well, they were not very united or didn't have a united body which stood together to give shelter to new families. Then I was wondering, Guru Tattva means the spiritual master is very important because his disciples don't really know much more than him. It's natural. The teacher in school is the most important. If he teaches you a mistake, you think the mistake is right because you got it from your teacher. So, in this way, it was obvious that in Guru Tattva this is very important, but how do I find anything which is going to give me some support, some sustain, and so that my disciples will not feel like rejected or not connected? These things are very important. So I was wondering who I can go to in the Gaudiya Math. Of course, we went to Srila Sridhar Maharaj and got his grace. We went to Srila Puri Maharaj and got his mercy. But there were personal affiliations which are very important. Any member of the Vrinda family, especially from those times, knows very well how important Srila Puri Maharaj was, how important Srila Sridhar Maharaj was, that we would go there and we would take his darshan and get his blessings and also do some service in connection with him. As a matter of fact, everything we do is a service to Srila Prabhupada and to his associates. So, in this sense, from this point of view, you can understand that that all these things are servicing, or you, everything we do for Lord Chaitanya in this world is actually one joint affair. even though it's divided in so many things. Just like when a father has 10 children, and 10 children start 10 families, and 10 families, each one will have 5 children. That's 50 children. That 50 grandchildren. For the grandfather, each one of the 51 are equally important. Because that's the responsibility of father and grandfather. So, in the same way for Lord Krishna, every devotee has the same importance. And what they do is of the same importance. It doesn't matter how good or bad he does it. If it's bad, Krishna has to correct him. If he does good, he'll send him more service. It's like that. The grandfather is always looking how to take the best advantage of a circumstance, because he wants to teach his children and his grandchildren so that they become mature, because they will carry the seed of him into the future. So father is very concerned that children and grandchildren know quite well what's going on, what's right and what's wrong. So in this sense, you're talking about a big family affair, big, huge family affair. Actually, the affair starts here, theistic Vedanta. Those followers of the Vedas who believe in a personal God. It cannot be a family if there are no father and no mother. And our father and mother is Lakshmi and Narayan, Radha Govindaji. Our father and mother is Mother Nature and Supreme Lord injecting energy. And we believe in a personal God. We believe in somebody who knows everything and who is guiding us and who can save us. So that's where it's born. You could say it's the theistic evolution, theistic revolution, progression. So I was looking for some support for my disciples. And then I studied, and when I talked to the people in Gaudiya Math, I could see that Chaitanya genealogical tree was divided already before Gaudiya Math. The genealogical tree, it's called in the Chaitanya Charitamrita, it's called the Chaitanya tree. There's a Nityananda monks, Advaita monks, there's Gadada monks, there's Gopal Guru Sampradaya, all these Mukunda and other, there's Shamananda Prabhu's Sampradaya. That means even after Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, the Vaishnava spread out into different branches which started going and representing Lord Chaitanya's mission in different degrees of power, just like some of the big temples, you know, Radha Damodar Temple, that's 450 years old. Radha Govindaji Temple, that's 450 years old. I mean, all these temples are medieval temples. They're coming from the Middle Ages, they're coming from the actual Goswamis and their families and friends. So we're talking about a very old culture, and still, that was just the beginning, because Chaitanya Mahaprabhu appeared 500 years ago, but Vedic culture was thriving and alive 1,000 years ago, 2,000 years ago, 3,000 years ago, 4,000 years ago, 5,000 years ago, when Krishna was here. So this wasn't like something new, but it had taken a special feature in the connection with Lord Chaitanya, a very special feature, because before Lord Chaitanya, here's Mahaprabhu, there's the four Sampradayas. There's the Rudra Sampradaya, Lakshmi Sampradaya, Kumara Sampradaya, and the Brahma Sampradaya. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came in the Brahma Matva Gaudiya Sampradaya. By his influence, it became Brahma Matva Gaudiya Sampradaya, is Mahaprabhu. After Mahaprabhu, or under the order of Mahaprabhu, there was an organization started called Vishwa Vaishnava Raj Sabha. That organization had been surfaced, then it had dwindled, it had disappeared, reappeared again, kind of disappeared, reappeared again. So it had a few ups and downs through the history. It was started by Srila Jiva Goswami. And then there was a very interesting commentary from my Guru Varga. Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur had said that the people of the future of these sampradayas, they will be very inspired by Mahaprabhu, and their sampradayas will actually come to connect their work with him. This we can have a little bit here symbolized. Not that they join completely, but that their inspiration association is taking place. This is already taking place in an informal way, but it may get much more formal and much more substantial in the future. But what happened is Brahma Sampradaya, Brahma Matva Sampradaya, Mahaprabhu's presence had a very big important impact on Kali Yuga, because Kali Yuga was ranting and raving already. There was so much nonsense going on, so much spreading of impersonalism, demoniac activities, terrible kings, and so on and so. So Mahaprabhu's appearance came when India was subjected to Muslim invasions. You know, the British had not arrived yet. The British disaster was still to come. The American invasion of internet and MVT, that hadn't arrived either yet. So still it was just Muslims, but they were pretty bad. And that was the circumstance when our Mahaprabhu appears. Mahaprabhu. And he was even a social revolutionary at his time. He went against the Muslim governments. He stopped the Chand Kasi and other things. And at the same time, he preached to Muslims, he preached to Buddhists, he preached to people from different type of backgrounds. And he showed to everybody what is universal love, something which we may actually write here as an additional feature, because this whole Sampradaya, Lord Krishna, they are standing for universal love. They are not standing for separatism. So the universal love principle is being represented by the true spiritualist, true theists. So, in my search, I came across the Vishva Vaishnava Rajshava, and with the help of other Gaudiya Vaishnavas from the many maths of Srila Prabhupada, we started the World Vaishnava Association. Actually, I could not have done so, but with the help of the disciples of Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, Bhakti Kanagiri Maharaj, Bhakti Vaibhav Puri Maharaj, Nayanandas Babaji Maharaj, Bhakti Pramod Puri Maharaj, and so many others, I can't remember all their names now, all those who were still alive and active, we got the endorsement to start the World Vaishnava Association. So the World Vaishnava Association counteracts the lack of support which is existing in an organized fashion, like in our case from ISKCON to us, or from Chaitanya Mahat to ISKCON, or from Chaitanya Mission to ISKCON and to us, or directly to us. Now here is a lot of ties of friendship, like we get so much friendship and support, but for the public relations and for the preaching, friendship and support is not as important as some actual backing, actually you may call it institutional backing or traditional, historical backing. It's more here the historical backing than the institutional backing, because you know every temple has to maintain its purity and its activities on its own. Very little of that will come to him from organizations otherwise. If you don't have your show together, you will be just be lost very soon. So, the backing we are talking about is a historical backing. It is a culture backing, because culture means the tradition of worship of God. So what is the tradition of Vrinda? Us? It is the history coming from ISKCON, coming from Chaitanya Math, coming from Chaitanya's genealogical tree, coming from the six Goswamis, coming from the Vishva Vaishnava Rajshava, coming from Mahaprabhu, coming from Brahma Madhvagoya Sampradaya, coming from the four Sampradayas. And above here, there's the transcendental features which you are all familiar with, Brahman, Paramatma, and Bhagavan. Only I've given them here, so we don't forget that Harinam, which everybody's chanting, coming from God Himself. Thakurji, our deity, is God Himself. Our way to find our Guru, Brahmanda Brahmite Kona Bhagyavana Jeev, Guru Krishna Prashade Vai Bhakti Lota Veej, is coming from Paramatma, the inner guide. So if you're involved in this, it's because of Him. It's not by any accident. Him and Guru there, He's the inner Guru, He's the outside Guru manifestation. So, and then Brahman, there's the general teachings of the Absolute Truth. This is also manifesting for us through the principles of Dharma and the manifestation of the Shastras. Of course, the Shastras are coming actually from Vyasa Deva. He's not Brahman, but he's teaching about Brahman, he's teaching about Paramatma, so it's a kind of, you could say, Shastra is in connection with all the fountainheads of, or teaching about all the philosophical aspects. So here we also make a guide, make a line, that he is coming to us in the form of Guru, the inner guide. And then Harinam and Thakurji are coming to you in the form of the mercy of the Guru. He's allowing you to chant holy name, he's allowing you to worship the Thakurji. So in this way you can get a kind of idea. This is a practical spiritual backing of our culture, and this is the backing of the history. Because we are talking sometimes, what is a world religion? Well, is Hinduism a world religion, or is it a village religion, or is it a concoction, or is it a do-it-yourself program, or what is it? Well, these questions arise specifically in the time of false prophets. And false prophets are not missing. There's false prophets everywhere. And false prophets means those who use religion for their personal materialistic gain. Whoever does it, doesn't matter, Christian, Buddhist, Hindu, Vaishnav, if anybody's using God and His teachings for his selfish gain, he's a false prophet, he's a bogey yogi, or however you may want to call it, and there's plenty of them. I've met quite a few myself on site. So, because of that, it is a very good question. What is the genuinity? What's the integrity? What's the historical backing of your worship? It's very important. Otherwise, they're going to say, well, you're a guru, then can you please produce a gold chain or shake out a little ashes from your head? If you can't, of Colombia. And I made the mistake to visit there, because when I heard that he has the people chanting Hare Krishna, I said maybe he's not all that bad. But when I went there, I saw a concentration camp of the most ugly site of spiritual indoctrination supposed to be, which was actually exploitation. I tell you, that was a shocking experience, how bogey yogis can distort things. Because he wasn't a Vaishnava at all, he was just making a hodgepodge, tutti-frutti of all spirituality, and then concluding of the thing that he was the worshipful Lord. And so in this way, there's plenty of things and people in this confused condition in this world, to tell you the truth, plenty. And because of that, the world is very, very doubtful. You could easily say that a larger part of atheism in the world exists because of the bad performance of those supposed to be devotees. So, specifically when you study Shraddha, when you study Oida therapy, and you see how faith is actually a natural ingredient of any kind of activity, and believing in something is the most natural thing to begin with, Well, then you can understand why do so many people have such substantial doubts. They are questioning God altogether and like that. So, because of that bad performance of all these horrible things, therefore, the question whether Krishna consciousness is a world religion, it is a very important question. And what is Hinduism? Where does it come from? And what are your roots and your traditional teachings? I mean, if you want to talk public relationship, you want to talk to the general public, you want to talk to the press, you want to go to the university and schools, here we have them, and you want to present all this, they will ask you, well, what's the tradition, what's the guarantees, what is really the line to follow, the line of thought, the intellectual, the scholastical backing, and. So, it's not something you can just invent or make some sentimental statement. They will not take it like that. So, they will ask you, who are you? Who's authorizing you to stand here and say that you're teaching about God? Where do you get that from? Is that religion or is this some invention, some bogus? So I was very concerned because I tell you, I didn't want to teach anything to anybody which was from me, because I'm empty, I have nothing. I'm just a little conditioned soul running around this world looking for that love I'm so anxious for. So I wasn't going to start, hey, I'm going to tell you about God. No, the only reason I opened my mouth is because I met Srila Prabhupada and met Srila Srinivas and heard beautiful things and experienced beautiful things, and I do have faith in what I'm standing for. I'm standing here on the shooting range. You can shoot at me. You can shoot your question. I mean, not bullets, no. I'm here to represent it, and if I'm not representing it, if you're not satisfied with my representation, then why should you try to follow me? Why should you try to obey me? Why should you do anything in Krishna consciousness if you're not feeling some confirmation, some support in this regard? So, in this way, we have come to understand the importance of the Vishva Vaishnava Ratshapa. But Vishva Vaishnava Ratshapa is very, let's say, it's very etheric for the people. That's why we changed it to World Vaishnava Association, which is a little bit more understandable point. This is an umbrella organization of those who believe in Vishnu, the Vaishnavas. So that's what we can understand. Vaishnavas, four sampradayas, an umbrella organization. Good. That's pretty clear. But what do the Vaishnavas stand for? Now, each Vaishnava, even today, they have a little different puja. They sing a little bit different. They have a few other mantras for meditation. Their deities look a little bit different. Okay, somebody worships Natadvar, somebody worships Sitaram, somebody worships Lakshmi Narayan, somebody worships the Paramatma directly. So there's different concepts of Vaishnavas and how they worship the Absolute. So what unites them? What's the uniting principle of the four sampradayas? What do they all agree upon? And where do they teach about Brahman, Paramatma, Bhagavan? Because this is Shastra. And this you can find in the word of Dharma. Dharma is mentioned, Sarva Dharma Paricharya. Give up all dharmas and surrender to me. Krishna says, yada yada hi dharmasya glanir bhavati dharmasya abhyutana adharmasya tatatmanam shijama. Krishna is taking directly credit. I am coming to give dharma. Now dharma has been made famous by Buddhists. Dharma is a well-known term. But what does dharma really stand for? Dharma stands for the healthy, positive, progressive behavior of humanity for everybody's well-being. And final destination is moksha or bhakti. Dharma, Artha, Kama, Moksha, the teachings of how to well behave, how to improve yourself, how to move up, how to go to the perfection of life. That is the purpose, that is the way of Dharma. So, Dharma is a very unifying term. Practically every one of the Sampradayas uses the term Dharma. For them, it is enhanced. They will call it Sanatan Dharma. To differentiate it from Dharma, Artha, Kama, Moksha, they will consider it is Sanatan Dharma. So I will put here the word Sanatan to make it more clear. But Sanatan Dharma is the eternal, but there's also a temporary aspect of it. That is the rules and regulations, the proper behavior. So, now, with the blessings of the Vishva Vaishnava Rajshava, we have started a new campaign of Dharma. You find this here. This is in one of the important features we will find today. You find here Dharma Signs. This Dharma Signs project is actually a project of the four Sampradayas. It is actually a project which shows the unity of all these aspects. Because we have to show unity. If everybody disagrees, there's no unity, no? If we disagree. The mantra for saving humanity is Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. No. Narada Muni gave to Dhruva Maharaj the mantra Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. No, somebody else is chanting Om Namo Narayana. So there's different mantras. The Gopal mantra is very famous. It's mentioned in Brihat Bhagavatamrita. And then there's so many others. No, it's not Hare Krishna. It's Radhe Shyam, Radhe Shyam, Shyam Shyam, Radhe Radhe. So we get the whole all mix up of holy names and different opinions, and we don't want to talk about it. Then we talk with our guru. That's our private sadhana. We don't have to make an issue out of it. Neither do we have to make an issue of what is the holiest place. Mathura, Badrinath, Rishikesh, Rameshwaram, Ujjain, Nashik, Haridwar, Allahabad, Triveni, Ganga Sagar, Gangotri, Yamunotri. What is the holiest of all holy places? Well, every Sampradaya has some holiest place, usually connected with their founder, Acharya. That's another thing. We're not going to debate it. There's no need to speak about it. There's no need to say. The other day one person told me, Radha Damodar is the holiest place on earth. There's nothing like that. And of course I agree, because my parampara also comes through Radha Damodar. But not to the point that, without the physical place of Radha Damodar, nobody can be Krishna conscious. That's more or less the same thing. Or other people have said to claim monopoly on certain things by claiming ownership of deities, claiming ownership of holy places. They have tried to create some institution rather making an institution rather than making a spiritual mystical school. So, and we are not interested in institutions. Institutions just they fulfill purpose. They're practical. They're like bodies. Cars are useful to come here. If it doesn't run, you don't stay next to the car and make arty to the car for the next 20 years. No, this car just gave up its function. So let's get rid of it, because it's a nuisance to have a car which doesn't run. No, it's actually a bigger problem here. So, in this way, a vehicle is a vehicle, and an institution a vehicle. An institution is not the soul. The body is not the soul, the car is not the soul, the institution not the soul. It's rather easy to understand, except for those who are in the society consciousness versus God consciousness. They are in the consciousness of my form, my holy place, my way of doing things, or my power over others, or whatever you may call it. It's really the external feature, which is not the Vishva Vaishnava Rajshava, because that stands for the pure devotees of Mahaprabhu, the king of the Vaishnavas, the most beautiful thing. So, in this way, this is a very important thing. You should understand that. Because if you understand this, you will be very strong in this world. You will be able to represent what is your guru about, what is his tradition all about, what is the guru tattva all about, what is the guru parampara all about, what is the position of the Lord about, what are the different approaches to the Lord. Some people, they say dharma, yes, but I don't believe in a personal God. Impersonalists, many impersonalists, they do subscribe to dharma, but not to Sanatana Dharma. Sanatana Dharma is Jaiva Dharma. Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur wrote this beautiful, beautiful book, Jaiva Dharma. Or we call it Oida Perennial Trichology, the eternal constitution, ontological position of the soul in relationship to the Supreme and its well-being in this connection. So this is basically just a return, is something helping us additionally. This is something else which I forgot here. This is the Oida therapy. This is also a very important part of approach to the public nowadays, to give this understanding, to have the wholesome, comprehensive understanding of who we are, and to be able to work on it, to develop it, and so many things. So, back to me and you. So I fixed that, in a sense. I said, yes, now I know who will back me up. Of course, your guru backs you up. That's finally last, but who backs him up? What's the principle? Okay, just explain. So, and by the blessings of all these people, we also defined that we have to relate to the general public, the general population. The general populations are divided in scientists, innocent people, Asuric criminals. Then we have people who think they know, they're called Hindus. And then we have people, they believe in God in one way or another, but they may not have all the exact conclusions, even though vegetarianism is fortunately found in most roots of most spiritual traditions. So in this sense, we are happy, because it would be a little bit difficult to have this utmost tolerance for those who slaughter cows. This is like would be just against our heart. No, we cannot swallow that. Anyhow, that's a separate issue. I'm not going to get sidetracked now. But the fact is that the original root of our religion is loving God and being there for the welfare of everybody. And that requires a very environmental consciousness. And this is, I haven't written that yet, it's very important also, because the environmental consciousness is Krishna consciousness. Environmental awareness. This is very important, and sometimes devotees neglect that. They don't realize that environmental awareness and Krishna consciousness cannot be in conflict with each other, because Lord Krishna is the husband of Bhumi, so Bhumipati is called. So he's the husband of Mother Earth. How is he going to go along with damaging Mother Earth, rivers, mountains, air, and everything? No. Krishna consciousness, the appropriate execution of it, and environmental consciousness, they have to be aligned. They have to be friends. You cannot separate the one from the other. It's not possible. So this environmental consciousness, environmental awareness, has to be part of Dharma. And luckily, it is. It's not a concoction, not an invention. This is Dharma. Now, we have a few other projects. First of all, we have a Dharma science. That's a very important thing, because it connects Dharma with the scientist community. Scientist community are the gurus of today. So they are kind of doing whatever they do. They get the degrade the grants and cheat, and they do anything but a real scientist, according to the understanding of science, is like the ethics of a doctor. The ethics of a doctor is he has to give up every comfort and give first aid, regardless of there's money, no money. You cannot sell it, there's an ethics. If a doctor denies first aid and help to a person because he has no money, he loses his right to execute his doctor profession. So this is an ethics. So ethics are very much connected with Dharma, but ethics are without the spiritual content. They're just taking the shell, just taking the rule or the useful application. Therefore, ethics is a big subject in Germany nowadays. Should they teach religion and ethics, or should they not teach anything about religion and ethics? So they're really confused, very poor. A society who cannot understand whether they should teach ethical principle to their children, that society is in shambles, you know? Because if you don't teach the children how to behave themselves, what are they going to teach to their children then? It's going to be a mess. So, this is a separate thing. So, Dharma science is connecting the scientists in a favorable way. It is connecting the innocent, because the innocent, they would really like to see that the religiosity and the science are congruent. And so it is up to us to find out how to prove that the scientists, or the true scientists, the true discoveries, actually confirm. Now, Dharma science is very much aligned with the Spoon Revolution and the Original Kingdom. Why? Because nowadays vegetarianism is not that we should be vegetarians because Krishna says you should be. That's fine, that's good enough for me. When they told me yogis are vegetarian, I said, well, I better be one too, you know. How can I eat all these poor animals? But that was for me. But nowadays, especially even in India, people want to hear it from the side of science. They want to hear the confirmation. Yes, this is true, because science has discovered the planet gets warmer by killing animals. The health goes down by eating meat, fish, and eggs. And so if science, now I have some very good friends, they're my scientist friends, they're called PCRM. If you have not heard about them, you can look them up and you understand why these guys are my friends. I work with them in South America, PCRM. It's a Physicians Committee for Responsible Medicine. They are the ones who produce all the scientific data why meat is very bad for you and for the planet, plus fish oil, plus any other product from the meat industry. So they're very good people in English, and we have a Spanish site. As most devotees don't know. Actually, most devotees don't know what I'm doing. That's a little bit why I'm also making this presentation this morning, so you're a little bit more informed. Another one is Nutri Costa Rica. I haven't done that in Germany yet, but we have a very extensive page on nutrition, which really shows, hey, you're not supposed to eat meat, it's bad for you, and here's the proofs, and here are the alternatives. Instead of this, you eat that. If you feel weak in your blood, if you feel you need iron, then you take this. In this way, the nutrition pages gives the actual research, the science, with backing of doctors, research papers. So if you have any doubt about it, go here. There's only one person I've seen doing it elaborately, that is the Switzerland Vegetarian Union. They are very extensive, researching, providing very good material. I think the Belgian also. There's a little bit of going on. But they don't know the connection with Dharma. They're missing out that important part. Because for us, vegetarianism, that's really Prabhupada's gift of prasad distribution, you know? One of the foremost approaches to the world, to the general population, is through prasad. This is the foremost. And of course, prasad distribution is connected with the restaurants and it's connected with the original king, and it's also connected with the conscious art, which I told you yesterday. We had the best of all marriages in the world. That was the marriage between the conscious art and the original kingdom, the spoon revolution. And of course, prasad distribution goes straight and connects to them as well, because this is, I mean, what is a festival without prasad? If I say we're going to have a mela with a fasting program of 3 days, I don't know how many people inscribe for that, you know? Maybe some people want to lose weight, and maybe get a few, you know? But otherwise, it's not, wouldn't be a very popular idea. So prasadam is an elemental feature. So I'm coming back. We resolve the philosophical, historical portion, where we come from, where we stand from. But now how to present this, my guru, to the general population? Because my next job. Now my guru, he gave me a few keys. Of course, Sadhu Sangha, association with devotees. Then how? Through prasad distribution and Sunday feasts. And more serious, through the ashraya, shelter of ashrams. This is because you want to join an ashram, or you're married, you want to know how to make a grihastha ashram. Then we have a few more features. Traditionally, Prabhupada sent us out on book distribution. Now it's book and CD distribution. Very important, because this is where people are finding out the basic. They find out that we exist. Without book distribution, Prabhupada wrote me a letter referring to the communists. He said they spread their ideas through literature over the entire planet. So his idea was that everybody intelligent should be connected to this. And it's going on very slowly but surely. Now we have the latest feature, the latest feature. That's really, really one. It's, you will be surprised. It is the distribution of slogans. It's Okis and Omis, we call them. And that has become, in a way, going along with the development of the world, because philosophical essays nowadays are read by very, very few people. Challenges, even debates. I mean, believe that. In our tradition, debate is a top important element. From the scriptures, we can see Ramanujacharya's time. If anybody was challenged to a debate, they couldn't refuse. They couldn't go say, no, you stupid guy, go your way, I do what I like. No. He was challenged by a debate. I once tried that before 1984, before when all my difficulties was going on. I said, it cannot be. I challenged my godbrothers to a debate, a public debate. I made it internationally aware. I'm here, I want you to explain these things or change these things. Believe it or not, I was debunked. Nobody showed up to the debate. It was in Radha Damodar, precisely in front of the Samadhi of Rupa Goswami. Not one person showed up to defend the behavior of ISKCON after Prabhupada. I tried it several times later in writing. No avail. We are not talking with you. Something to drink, please give me the cup. So it's not the time today of debates and reading. People just don't read. People don't read and people don't discuss philosophy. It's very strange. People just watch television and accept it or fall asleep and they think they didn't accept what they did. The intellectual level of exchange is not too high. Therefore, you can understand even book distribution is not being so easy. Even though some people have been quite expert in distributing many books, but getting people to read those books, that's another story, you know? If I have a mechanical system of distributing books, which are just going to be shelved somewhere, this is not really an accomplishment. So I have to try to get people to read Prabhupada's books. This is what this is all about. Because I do want people to read my spiritual master book, or to listen to his classes, or to listen to watch his videos, become purified in his association. And this is really the whole idea. We don't need to distribute books. We need to get people to want to read the books. This is the crucial thing. And I know Srila Prabhupada would be sitting here. I could get his wholehearted approval on that. But still the mechanism of distribution of things are very important. And so therefore we have switched a lot to CDs, because it's more easy for people to listen to a class than to read a book. So we are making audio books. For the simple, and those who want to have it complicated, we have the book also. Those who are still philosophically minded, then okay, we have the books. The book tradition cannot stop. It comes all the way from the Lord. It's the Shastras. We cannot do away with the Shastras. Only the pitiful situation in the world is that people don't read the Shastras. So we are trying to adapt it. So you start getting an idea how everything here has a position, has an interactive, interrelating function. And it took a long time. As a matter of fact, most of these things are done in South America. Many of these things in German language, they have nothing, or very, very, just a fragment. Only in Sweden, they are very dynamic. They have a lot of stuff because they're really curious. What is going on? Let us try to do the same here too. But now, especially through Dharma Science and the World Vaishnava Association in connection with the four Sampradayas, they are now doing this campaign for India, for the Hindus. Because the Hindus today, they think that Bill Gates is more important than Ramanujacharya. I'm sorry to say so, and I hope all the Indians get angry with me when I say that. They should scream at me, "No! Bill Gates is a folly. He's nothing, just a man with money. He's nothing. But our acharyas, they sustain the culture of this planet." But most of them will not object. So Bill Gates, yeah, Bill Gates, wow. Microsoft, yeah, we want to be soft, full of micros. Plus, if that would be the only thing, that Indians love money, no, but now they love the Western lifestyle. They're breaking. They stop being vegetarian in big quantities. So we're talking about a major problem of loss of Dharma, and that's why Dharma Science is getting into action to approach the general public in the level, the general public in the world is getting the Okis, and the Indians get especially the Omis. Of course, they can be exchanged also, it's not a hard and fast rule. But why? Omis are based on reincarnation logic, karma logic, things logic which Indians still can relate to. Where Westerners, if you tell them reaction, they say, "What's that?" They can't relate to it, many of them. So here we are. This is like public action interrelationship. Because, for example, here, the Prabhupada said that the general population is innocent. They just don't know. Nobody has told them. And then there's a few, they're asuric, demoniac, criminal. They don't really care. They just want to make money at any way, at any cost. So they are very difficult to talk to. If somebody doesn't care, if somebody is like an owner of a big slaughterhouses. Even though I've just recently, one devotee was telling me that her friend, her husband is working in a bakery where they sometimes use meat and eggs also. And the son of the owner when he came in contact with Krishna consciousness, he became very attracted. I mean, we have had many cases where people turned from wrong activities into right activities, and some of them quite dramatic. It's not so easy. When you make all your money with something illicit and then to give it up, I've had more than one disciple crack on that. They couldn't resist. They could say, oh, this money is coming in, maintaining my family. Now I'm going to give it up because it's some sinful activity. There was one famous group of Colombians. They all loved Krishna. The whole family had attraction for Krishna, but their way of income was a line of alcohol and tobacco ware sales. And they were wealthy. They were making good money with this alcohol and cigarettes. You know, that's a big business. People are addicted. So then they had to come to the standard. Now, how do they do that? Do they give up this business? And of course, they were like a 10-member family. And then, of course, they said, are you crazy? We're not going to give up the business. And then some of them were making money, but it was coming from that source. Was a headache, you know, a big headache. By now, 8 of them are devotees, 2 are still hanging on to the business. I mean, the calamity lasted through for the last 27 years. So it's not so easy, no? Sometimes in life things are just not that easy. And still Krishna consciousness goes on. The Dharma values have to be spread and all that. Anyhow, so I'm just putting you in that situation in that to understand that we try our best, but it's not always one-day solutions. Sometimes it takes a long time. And so in this way, all the things you see here between the public relations, oh, here's some very important things. Of course, for expanding Sadhu Sangha, we also have the inbound yoga and the inbound yoga tours. We have the Vedic wisdoms, answers to all the problems of life from the Vedic thoughts. Then we have the internet sanghas, very important, how to communicate with the world through internet, through sites and newsletters, and other through chat rooms, for example, very important, like the Sunday chat room of Vrinda has a very long tradition. I've seen some of you come and some of you go, but the chat didn't go, it's still there. Because it's a very lively thing that we can actually talk, because I can't visit every temple every week. I would like to. I would like to see each one of you once a week, really. But we can meet, or you can read what we discuss every week for the last 10 years, or who knows how many, I think. In Italy, we went on this beautiful... What was it? I forgot.
Vienna.
No, just a few days back. Uh-huh. It's Vyasa Puja. Ramnaomi, where were we in Italy?
Terni,
yeah. And, no.
Ramananda Roy's house. Or Rimini.
I think it was in Rimini. Yeah, in Rimini we saw this. We joined the Bhakti Balatirtamash Vyasa Puja. Anyhow, these are very modern things and they are very important. And here we also have another thing, the Hindu ID. What is the Hindu ID? This is identification before the general population, because they can understand whatever comes from India has to have something with the name Hindu. Then they can say, aha, Hindu, oh ho. So they think, well, they identify all this with Hindu. We don't. We do identify it with Sanatana Dharma. But that's just a question of wordings. It doesn't really matter very much. But that's why you find us using sometimes the Hindu identification. Because Hindu identification means Sanatana Dharma identification. It means our 4 Sampradayas. Now, a very interesting feature. First time in the history, all the Gaudiyas are working together with all the Sampradaya for the Dharma, for the general population. This, you please, I will repeat it. Really, by the action of the Vishva Vaishnava Rajkava, we got all the Gaudiyas to agree on one point, to work with them together for the sake of Dharma, joining us to give this knowledge to the general population. This is a unique feature which is just taking place, and I'm working on that up till Kumbh Mela. We will have a very a big presentation in India, in Hindi, of the Dharma science work. I am working very hard with the Swedish devotees and with our Colombian office. And if you want to have the same program in Portuguese or in Spanish, no, in Spanish we already have it, or in German or Swedish, then you have to do that. And that's up to you, because I have my head full with English and Hindi. That keeps me busy. So, but this is the same. Now, we are working up for Kumbh Mela, but from there it will go to the general population, because last but not least, yoga and the yogis and the saints of India are increasingly popular. Why? Because they give solutions. They give solution for the social problems. They give solution for the environmental problems. They give solution for the ignorance problems in the world, philosophical ignorance. And here we have another nice feature, which nowadays has not been mentioned so much, which is the House of Wisdom and Ayurveda Therapy. This is also work, because the Ayurveda Therapy is the official system of therapy used in the House of Wisdom. The House of Wisdom is our charity. Now, House of Wisdom is not directly affiliated with this. House of Wisdom is affiliated with wisdom, with any wisdom. So House of Wisdom is very much associated with the Dharma, science, and Ayurveda therapy. Very important. So we can see from this that the House of Wisdom is where we apply Krishna consciousness. How do devotees deal with the world? How do they deal with people who are dying? How do they deal with people who are spoiling their health? How do they deal with people who are misusing the environment? So this is also the environmental consciousness is directly connected to House of Wisdom and Dharma Science. These are all, you know, you have a lot. The program is closed because people in this world are very wary of proselytization. This is an important thing here, proselytization. This is a very bad word. Really, it's not. What is proselytization? I want to do the best in my life, and I want you to also do the best in your life. I think I know what's the best for my life and for your life, and I want you to know from me what is the best thing for your life. Who is the proselytizer number one? He's a doctor. The doctor tells you, dear patient, you're sick, this is your diet, and then you have to do this. So, when the doctor gives you an advice, you have to pay for it. When people pay for it, they think it's not proselytizing. Actually, university and schools, nowadays, they are under the money of big industry, and they all proselytize. Proselytize can be open, can be hidden. There's even propaganda manipulation. One of the ways of proselytization is, it's called subliminal advertisement. It's like when you watch a movie and the guy in the movie is drinking a Johnny Walker whiskey, then you never talk about it, it's never thought about, but it is an advertisement for Johnny Walker. And this is this subliminal advertisement has different features. It even has features where they blend in pictures where you don't even see it. They make like bum bum bum, no? And these pictures go so fast on the screen you can't even make out what it was, but you get hooked on it and you go out and buy yourself some soft drink or eat ice cream. So there's a lot of subliminals going on. And subliminals, all this belongs to proselytization. Proselytization is a bad word. People say, what, you want to proselytize? What, you want to tell me what to do? You dare to think you know it better? Oh, we don't accept that. Oh, we don't like that. Oh, get out of our way. So in one sense, God has given us an ear, God has given us a mouth. If I have no ear, I can't hear. If I have no mouth, I can't speak. So God has given us this function so we can share the good things we have seen and we can teach each other. That's what parents use their mouths. So in this sense, the whole thing is very questionable. Proselytizing means if you give something wrong for a selfish purpose, that's proselytizing. What's not for that purpose has a different name. It's called education. Education has a very high prestige. It's very necessary. We all accept that we have to be educated. Every philosophical system educates. Every communist, capitalist, every system in the world believes in education, but everybody uses it for proselytization. And they all say, hey, proselytization, real bad, real bad. You're proselytizing. So the churches tell you, don't let yourself be proselytized, and then you go to church and they proselytize on you. So it's something like that. So it requires a power of discrimination. It really has to. So we will judge it by how much Dharma science backs up a thing. If Dharma science backs up an element, it becomes education. If Dharma science doesn't back it up, it becomes proselytization. So this is a very important department, educational department. Is this advertisement for eating more, sleeping more, dreaming more, getting this pill or that pill, is this education? No. It is manipulation. Proselytization, now we associate proselytization with some religious thing, but wait. You have to consider that the biggest religion nowadays is materialism. The people believe in materialism. So the proselytization for consumerism is actually the proselytization of the materialism to call, to catch you. So therefore, these things are very important to identify. But when we, the representative of my guru, when we speak to the general population, we have to be very cautious so that we will not be accused of just wanting to proselytize. No, we want to educate. So how do I convince them that I'll educate you? For that is all these departments, all these things, they are nothing but efforts Srila Prabhupada started. I will show you how. The Dharma science, that is entirely coming from the Bhaktivedanta Institute. The Ovida therapy is coming from the Bhaktivedanta Institute. The House of Wisdom is coming from the Vaishnava charity works which have been going on in many different features. Then conscious art, it comes from Krishna and from all the beautiful artists who wanted to glorify God in history. So Original Kingdom is a new idea for spreading vegetarianism. It's a humorous contribution which obviously subscribes to Dharma science, because we cannot tell people things if they are not accepted. As a matter of fact, the Original Kingdom and the Spoon Revolution works on the platform of what we call axiomatic truths. Self-evident, when things are just beyond question, you just have to say, yes, yes, I guess it's true, what can I say? Well, I don't really like it, I don't live according to it, but seems to be confirmed that science said, you know, this type of truth, you know? Killing is not nice. Well, most people will agree. I mean, not all of the people. Some people are making fun, getting fun from killing others. But these are belonging to this section here, Asuri criminal. So we don't expect much good return from this part of the society, you know. They're not going to be too fired up about anything we are doing, you know. But the innocent, they will agree, killing is not nice. So can we live without killing? How can we avoid killing? So the whole thing, you know, this is a very large area of engagements. And Krishna has kept me, Krishna has me on my neck. I just got the news yesterday that we got a restaurant given to us in downtown Miami, in not downtown, but very close to the downtown of Miami, where we are supposed to make another center of vegetarian awareness. For that purpose, it was practically given because of the Spoon Revolution. Now we have to see what we're going to do with this. Now I got another problem to take care of, how to run a restaurant in Miami. So in this way, but this is like, there's so many things. Like when we started Spoon Revolution activities in South America, it became a large engagement, so many new service, because we just have a few devotees, you know. How many things can a few devotees do? Bhakti Shakti saying, help! In Sofia we need more help. There's so many things to do. Who's going to do it all? So in this sense, and then everybody has its own personal agenda. As well, people have to say, "Oh, what am I going to do with my life?" And so it's not easy, but that's what it is, and we have to just learn to live with it. We have to dance with the punches, like Nietzsche used to say. This life is a big dance, but of course we dance with Lord Chaitanya's music, not just with the punches. First with the kirtan, sweet music, and then with the punches of our surrounding world. So, what you can see here is a little bit of a layout of what is our offering, which we have made to our spiritual master, which is the offering of Vrinda. That's what I just explained to, that's what Vrinda stands for. This is my efforts. And there's many, many more details, each of every one of these subdivisions. I mean, if you want to see what means internet in Vrinda language, you have to go to vrindaportal.org. You have to go there. Let's just make a test. Those who have never looked at Vrinda Portal amongst you, please lift your arm. Those who have not seen that site, high up to get an idea. Yeah, that means we are not very communicated. Vrinda Portal is the entry to all departments. I'm surprised Shruti Maharaj has never been there. He probably can't read on the screen because his own site of Portugal is also there.
So well, there I've seen it also. I've also seen it. I raised my hand, but I just don't know the name. I did see it.
Yes, Vrinda Portal. It's the entry site to all the different internet. So when I'm saying Vrinda Portal, it's just a teeny little port here, but in the reality behind this little, there's at least 100 devotees working in different countries and different moments, but hard work going on just on this one department. In the book publishing and book distribution, give it another 100 devotees are working here. So actually, plus a distribution. Now, there's many, many devotees, but then again, I would describe what we are doing is absolutely in its pampers. It's like we are just the first steps of approaching society with the same mood. It's just the beginning, and it's the beginning which you have to continue. Because I won't be around when it becomes more serious, you know. It's already taken serious feature. We had the other day Spoon Revolution Festival sponsored by the city of Bogota. Believe it or not, the Bogota city gave a grant of $5,000 for a one-day festival. They wanted to make it real beautiful because there was a sympathizer there of the vegetarian movement. Because nowadays, you know what the situation? You'll be laughing. The scientific discoveries, the situation of the planet is as such that nowadays governments have to finance those who promote vegetarianism to improve the ecological situation of the planet. That's the spirit how we get such support. They say, yeah, we have to help, people have to stop eating so much meat. It becomes a concern. Do you know, my dear friend, do you know that ever since the vegetarian movement started in the world, meat consumption has risen dramatically on the planet? Do you know that? Were you aware of that, Garuda? There's many, many more people eating meat than when the vegetarian movement started. Why? What's the reason? Very simple. Poorer people in China and India, who previously were not eating meat, are getting big economies now, and they want to live like Americans, they want to eat in fast food chains, and they're opening those fast food chains everywhere, and people eating meat and meat and meat. The production, I don't really remember the exact number, but it's something like up 30%. The meat, the killing is up, the meat eating is up. Then we haven't really hit a jackpot as far as the vegetarian movement is concerned, but we are on the work because, so at this point, if you look at that, you see the environmental effects of the meat industry, then you can understand why actually governments may sympathize with those who promote not eating so much meat for the health. Like in the PCRM, they already accomplished that many universities and schools which didn't offer vegetarian diet previously, now they have it. Because I say you have to give this alternative to the people, otherwise there's a lot of things going on. So, when we did this festival in Bogota, the mayor of two cities heard about it. One of them actually came on site and he said, I want this festival in my city immediately. Also, here's a contract. Come and do it there again. So, and then we have had like, in a sense, some of these things you see here have had a very good response. Better response than our proselytization, which we never really do by heart, we always work on education, but when we work straight on these, some of these indirect programs, then we see that the people are more fired up. Of course, because they're being fed a lot of fear. Christians in Europe, they feed fear into the people. Another religious group, you find an ashram, a guru, oh no, very dangerous, and they have made intensive propaganda against, practically, der Aufbetrag für Sektenfragen der evangelischen Kirche und der katholischen Kirche, they are practically the high priests of today, and one of the top ones became Pope. One of the top discriminator against anything thinking different than the empire, that was the person who they made the Pope now. So they are working very hard in this to try to take people away from new ideas, Eastern ideas. They are so scared that they have meditations in the churches, they don't know, because they can see the trends are changing, because they got good information there. They're working with the top universities, with the inquiries, so they know that. And we are working on our side, humbly and determined, that we want to please Srila Prabhupada, our guru. That is, all this is an offering to Srila Prabhupada, if you ask me. I don't think I'm a social reformer. I don't think I'm a revolutionary of any value. Save and except conveying and transmitting my Prabhupada, my Gurudev's revolutionator, because all these things come from him. They're just extensions, expansions of his ideas. That's all they are. This is the same movement of Lord Chaitanya. Lord Chaitanya came and he brought this, and that's what he's bringing. And this is all the working together which we are trying to offer to give it a solid backing, but not an institutional monopolization. You will not find, hey, where's the GVC? Where's Vrinda's GVC? Well, you know, maybe we should have one. But We have something else, we call it the CBA in South America. It is a group of temple presidents, sannyasis, and some senior devotees who are like accountants. They go to temples and they just check in the temples, are you doing the basics? How are you doing? There's a report card. So they're filling out, do you do what you're supposed to do? And this is like, and it's not like a big institutional operation, but it does have some representatives. They're like temple presidents. And they don't come to visit the temple to disturb the temple, but they have all the right to know everything. There's no secrets. Oh, no, we don't tell anything we do. Yes, you better tell, because we want to know. We want to know whether your temple is actually up to the mark of Srila Prabhupada. And that's difficult. You know, to be up to the mark of Srila Prabhupada, my God, you know, I'm shaking my boots. Srila Prabhupada had incredible standards and had incredible things. But in Srila Prabhupada's movement, there were things which we have that were not there at that time yet. And they're very good. So in that sense, there's also new heirs, new spirits, but to keep up the standards to Prabhupada, my God, you know, that is a real struggle, because you have to convince people to really be iron solid, like how they call it, this Iron Man competition in the world, the super Iron Man, those who get up early, go into cold water. Now we have a little training these days for those who want a little bit of refreshing experiences. Then you run, then you swim, then you climb a mountain, then you do this and find it. So it's an Ironman competition. To be a temple president, you have to be more tough than an Ironman, I tell you that one. So we have a lot of training there. And that training is for becoming qualified to serve humanity, because that's what it's all about, universal love. Krishna comes to love everybody. The Paramatma is in everybody's heart to love and help everybody. Brahman is the underlying principle. The Guru is the friend of all. The Vaishnava, the Sadhu Sangha, the Paraduka Duki, they want to help the whole world. This whole idea is to help the world to get out of illusion, out of ignorance. If not, why be involved? Why participate? So I wanted to share these ideas this morning. I hope you copy this for your personal notes. Because it's actually, of course, without the personal explanation of it, it's more difficult. But at least you get an idea of what is like the interactions and how it works and which way we are going to go. And I just hope that you will be a valuable contribution. Now you may feel that's a bit complex, a little bit too complicated. I don't know if I can relate to so many departments. And as a matter of fact, you probably can't. But you should know that they exist. You should know what they are for. You should understand why the spiritual masters made such a large layout. You see, because if you compare that to a multinational company, it's still not really complex. It's a rather simple thing. But simple or not simple, it has to be done. It's because it goes. It is not simple because it goes deep into a person and changes their habits, changes their way of looking upon life, which usually people don't do. They just want to sell you something. But if you change people's habits and ways of life, then you become also connected with them. You also take some responsibilities. And those responsibilities we are responding through in the ashraya, the shelter, in the ashrams, in the training, in the Vaishnava Academy. You know Vaishnava Academy? That's what Vaishnava Academy is, a thing which is connected to our education. It is connected to training up of new devotees. And our new Vrindakunja in Berlin, it will be our Vaishnava Academy, where Swami Maharaj and myself will design courses for people to learn, so they can come here and stay for a month or two and learn and learn and learn, and then take that knowledge back. Of course, in Sweden we right now have a big academy too. Everybody's working on these projects. That's another way of learning. But Vaishnava Academy and this education of the general population, of course, and then it is, the Vaishnava Academy is connected to the shelter giving in the ashrams, because the education has to go there and it has to go to the general population. It's the education of a new consciousness, of a new awareness. Anyhow, enough of this for this morning. I thank you very much for giving your rapt attention to this, and I hope you can help me expand it, because last but not least, this is just a beginning step, as I said. But we do not have a big house of wisdom, because we don't have many people. This is for volunteers. Many of these things will only work through volunteers. Like, I can't send the devotees distributing okis and omis around the world. They have other things more important to do. So we really have to get, we have to involve newer people, different people in things like that. So, therefore, it would be my greatest joy if you embrace these type of responsibilities and carry them to your country. In a very humble way, of course, because we are just a few people, but at least that's the effort we are doing, that's the direction we are taking. And with the blessings of Shishi Guru Guranga, with the blessing of our Guru Parampara, blessings of Gandharvika Govinda Sundara, we will have a very nice center of education in Berlin. Krishna was very merciful to us. I was aspiring for that indirectly, because our previous temple, like Kurukshetra, is really nice, but it didn't have so many facilities for residential facilities. And now we are also having permit to make a temple and many study rooms. So I think the Vrindakunja Berlin has a beautiful reappearance and a reincarnation, because we had it before, and it will really do something, help at least the European mission. But as I say, all this is applicable in any place of Vrinda, anywhere in the world. It's only a question of how much can I apply, how much time I have, how much things. But this is not more for Germany than more for Sweden or more for Hungary. No, it's for everybody. And that's why I took advantage of this meeting with you. And I pray that you may feel joy to be involved. Because if you don't feel joy, then you will not be able to convey the importance to others. Any questions?
What means Omi?
Omi, that's a good question. Omi, I should relate, it is actually, from my point of view, Gayatri Devi. She's actually the female spokesperson of the original kingdom. And she is the counterpart of Oki. Oki is the representative of zero killed. He's male, she's female. She's also the representative of the mother, of Mother Earth. She's the queen, so to say, representative of the queen. So in the original kingdom, you find Omi is in this case especially the one who uses arguments based on karma and reincarnation. So she's teaching more the Hindu section of the Spoon Revolution. This was specially made for now, and her department extended together with Dharma Science, and this department is really going to be the main introduction into Kumbh Mela. And at Kumbh Mela, it is going to join with the four Sampradayas, so it's going to be a very exciting experience. We will interview all the Acharyas in the Kumbh Mela, and afterwards and before also. And all these interviews will be published in Dharma Science in the form of YouTube clips, so that we can show how they are all enthusiasts in defending the principle of Dharma, something which we all unite upon. That's a mythology. Mm-hmm. More questions? Yes.
The house of wisdom, no? How is it taught? I mean, is it like an institution in the city, or It should be like a place where people can go, like an emergency.
Yes. Yes. Thank you for asking. The House of Wisdom, they are independent houses from the temples. They are not in the temples. They have a database, they have a secretary. They have a lecture room where they give lectures, informations about what is right and what's wrong. The Dharma, the House of Wisdom also does projects outside. Actually, the House of Wisdom is active right now in Peru, in Ecuador, in Colombia, and Chile, and a few more features in Mexico also. It really requires a kind of a larger setup, at least 50 devotees in the city. In Berlin, we could do a House of Wisdom operation if we would have who wants to do it, because every single one of these things depend of I want to do it. I will get it done. Otherwise, nothing happens. Just because my wishful thinking will not do it. So House of Wisdom, if you want to know how it works, in there the website, houseofwisdom.org, a very nice website. It gives you a very good introduction of how it can work. There's, for example, 20 chapters of different works House of Wisdom is thinking, and already growing, maybe 25. And there's a preparation, there's like a teacher's guide, where if you are working, for example, for helping people to leave the body, then yes, if you feel like that, then you read the training and you get actually trained. So in this way, House of Wisdom is preparing lots of things to read. It's a bit intellectual. It requires people with a little bit of thinking and ability to reach out to others. So basically that's the most important thing. Anybody can do it. House of Wisdom can have in one house 20 houses, in one city 20 houses for the each chapter one. There's no hard and fast rules. It's just some ethical principle which are taught, which are the basics. It's just like the inbound yoga tours, as many